We're going to stop right there, and I'm going to open up the floor for some comments. Go ahead, Lala. You over there about to bust as usual.
Man, you just, those two chapters, oh my gosh. I figured as the, I was going to do that. I was gonna do that too, but I'm glad you're doing it though. And the chapter you just left off of was valuing yourself.
Yeah.
And how can you have all of those different resources at your fingertips and still just let it fall through the cracks?
Mm-hmm.
Realize potential when you see it. You know, even though you may still want to do, you know, black ink by yourself, but when you have an opportunity, see what you can do with those resources. Don't just let them just fade away and not act like they don't exist, because somewhere they can help you and they even grow it bigger and they come on board. They'll be under you. You never know what can happen. So
exactly.
That was just some hot stuff. Hot stuff.
We've got my engineer extraordinaire, Mr. Daniel Dennis. He's been touched by something that was said enough to want to step in here and contribute his two cents too. Go ahead, Dan.
I want to make a comment in the last part. The record business today is not what it was 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago. Amen. And really, that doesn't even really matter. The comment you made about record company basically wants to sign you up, and they're there to make money. It's a business.
Mm-hmm.
So they're going to want as much as they can grab.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I teach a recording at our school, which I don't know if I should say the name here.
Go ahead, man. Shameless plug, brother. I went here too. I got my engineering degree here.
Tommy is a former student of mine. He's a graduate of Recording Institute of Detroit. Anyway, we had a student here 4 years ago, four years ago. He took classes, started a label, got an artist. They make money. They sell downloads. That's all they sell. They're not going through a record company. They're promoting it. It costs them $0
to do it online.
That's how they promote.
Mm-hmm.
It's just their time, no cash, and they've got 3 gold records by now.
Damn.
They have a number one comedy at one point, the number one comedy label in America. A record company which will remain nameless, as soon as they became successful, flew them out.
Mm-hmm.
Flapped $100,000 in front of each of their faces, try to sign them to a deal.
Mm-hmm.
And you look at the contract and it's just not worth it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, I mean, the money, yeah, it looks great, but you know, when you actually read the details, and that's what you have to do in this day and age, you want to succeed, you got to pay attention to everything.
Mm-hmm. And you can't be in a rush. And the sad thing too about that, that's why it's also good to have a day gig. Because I used to be a starving artist. And when you're a starving artist and somebody waves some money in your face, it's a lot more enticing, because it's like, damn, you know, these ramen noodles and these sardines have done got old and this motherfucker's talking some loot. So have you a day job so you can at least maintain the basics so that you can turn down them what I call nigga deals.
Anyway, that was my comment.
Thank you,
sir. Going back to the control room.
Brother Kofi, you had something to say?
Brother, I'm enjoying this. You know, I was struck by the comment you made about the box. And thinking outside the box. And that's something that, and that's the whole, one of the things is that I talk to young people every day, and they come to me with ideas, and they're always trying to fit ideas that they have into what exists.
Yeah.
Well, when you go to messing with what exists, you're already too late.
Yeah.
You're signing on to, you know,
somebody else's
concept. To a train that's loaded.
Yeah.
When you come out of the box, I mean, that's how I encourage them that to come out your own brain.
Yeah.
And when you come out your own brain, the first thing you're going to hear from everybody is that it ain't going to work, because they ain't never heard it before. Right. That's what new is.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Old don't make money. So there's an old record.
Right.
So thinking outside of the box is an important thing. Not only thinking outside the box, living outside of the box.
Yes, sir.
Because that's one of the tragedies, I think, when you start talking about as we raise our young, which is what this is all about, as we parent and as we teach, right?
Yeah.
It's to think out of the box, to create out of the box.
So you ain't boxed in.
And then don't get back in the box.
Yeah.
But when you aspire, and that's one of the things that I see today, that most of us, and even sometimes myself, we aspire to be a part of that which don't want us to be a part of it.
Yeah, exactly. And I ain't never been the type who wanted to go to a party I'm not invited to.
No.
If I'm not welcome at your shit,
right,
I'm good.
Absolutely. And I'm not begging nobody to take my money.
Yeah. You know? Mentality, I'm sorry.
Because you touched on a lot of serious and critical subjects in these last few chapters. That's why I wanted to chime in here. But I'm going to try to keep it quick. One, speaking on thinking outside the box, it's hard to think outside the box. You know, when your teacher is that box that's teaching you how to stay in that box. And I'm talking about a lot of our youth watch a whole lot of TV. Uh-huh. That's teaching them a whole lot of nothing. And they follow it. They believe it. When you talk about the disciple, which is the root word for discipline.
Yeah.
And a lot of people really don't think about what they're hearing or don't pay attention. But the disciples were, they followed. They followed their leader, Yahshua. And he led by example. And that's what it's saying when it's telling you to discipline your children. I mean, you are showing them the way. You are leading by example. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times they don't get that discipline. They just get straight up raw punishment. And some of the things, like you said, the difference between religion versus spirituality.
Yeah.
Religious unnecessarily spending causes a lot of financial failure. Like when you said the thing about Christmas, you get a lot of people who would be broke. You know, and they don't have a lot of money. They're working at Walmart, or you working at Top Hat, and you know, and,
yeah.
you're going around and you done spent $2,000 on Christmas.
Yeah.
And you are $800 behind on your light bill. Matter of fact, you're turning your lights on illegally, gas on illegally, and we put ourselves more so in the hole. And when you look at, I'm just saying, like the Chinese, I brought this up to somebody, and you might have about 15, 20 of them that live in a house, and we'll look at that like, oh, hell no. Nah. Mm-hmm. But the same people that's saying, oh, hell no, nah, are the ones that's broke and struggling and things like that. But that's because that philosophy was not taught to you. But if you look at these same people, if I'm correct, these are the ones that own a lot of the car companies and the beauty supplies and things like that. It's obviously they're doing something right.
Mm-hmm.
So the other thing is the belief thing.
Yeah.
I'm going to say this and I'm going to be quiet. When I first came out with my book, before it came out, it almost seemed like it was a dream that would just never come true. And that was because all my life, my mother struggled, my father struggled. So pretty much that's what I knew, struggling. You know what I'm saying? I didn't really know success. I didn't even know what it looked like. Every time, it would always be failure. So I would almost expect failure, you know, just so I don't be disappointed. So when you say you had to believe in yourself, it took other people telling me that I was good enough.
Yeah.
And I started believing in myself, and I actually came out with it. So you touched on a lot of strong issues, and I suggest anyone who is listening to this to take heed to those things for real.
Yes, sir.
You know, so thank that's you, my man. Gist on this wonderful thing you're doing here, Brother Raku.
Yeah, okay.